there, friends. Thanks for joining us here today on Expanded Perspectives. Of course, I'm Cam Hale, and as usual, joining me today, I've got a new one for him. He is the Splenda to my coffee, Mr. Kyle Filson.
How's it going, everybody? Splenda. You actually put Splenda in your coffee? Ever tried that?
Yeah, I have tried Splenda.
What do you think?
Well, I tell you, I don't like it. I don't like that. And also, what is that, stevia?
Yeah, I've tried
I made
that.
A huge mistake on stevia one time, and I just was like, just throw it in there like you did. It don't take that much.
No, it's powerful.
Yeah, that stuff got up and got me. I was like, what is going on? Yeah, it put the whooping on me. So, folks, hope y'all are having a wonderful day. Hope everybody had a great weekend. We're going to have some fun today. We have got some really interesting stories, some really fun news articles. So we're going to dive into it, try to make y'all's day a little bit better, at least to get through work. And it makes our day fun just to come and do this. Philly, did you have a good weekend?
I had an excellent weekend, yeah.
The weather was awesome. I spent a lot of time on the water, a lot of fishing, caught one fish. I fished all day Saturday. I caught one fish.
Hey.
That's why I was fishing. I wished I could catch. I wish I was a catching guy, not just a fishing guy.
It takes practice, my
catcherman
friend.
Instead of a fisherman. But yeah, so I did a lot. Let me ask you this, man. If you ever, whenever, and we do it now getting older, hopefully people can relate to this. If not, I'm the only old sissy. Like, you ever just like been playing or something, snatch up like a, let's say, a golf ball or just a little rock, and you go to throw it. When you get done, you're like, man, my arm's sore. Like, I didn't realize, like, you try to throw it almost like too hard, like it's too light. I guess, you know, like you throw your arm out is what they call it or something.
Right,
like
yeah.
That.
You got to warm your arm up.
Yeah. I felt like that after throwing that spinning reel yesterday, because I was throwing like a little old lightweight roadrunner, like a little chartreuse roadrunner.
Right.
And I'm throwing that spin in that wind, and I'm just throwing that and throwing it and throwing it. And I'm like, oh, my arm's going to fall off. Boy, I got up today. I was like, woo, yeah. A few days afterwards, my arm's a little sore now.
Yeah. Yeah. Luckily, my arm's pretty strong when it comes to stuff like that, because I throw the baseball
with them all the time. Yeah.
Yeah. But I know what you're saying, yeah.
It was funny.
It gets stiff. It'll even be stiff for a couple days.
Yeah, I was like, man, why? What is going on? Sitting there whipping it into, but that's what it was, throwing it into the wind. The problem is you try to man up and throw it as far as you can. You know, you're like,
of course.
I got to get all the lake under one cast. You know, and I'm just a moron. But yeah, had a great time, great weekend. So let's jump into some cool stories. Now, look, I've read a little bit of this, but I don't know a whole lot. You were telling me something very interesting about something that had to do with some NASA and some Pink Floyd, and I'm not sure what was going on. Is that not it? What have I got going on
here? Yeah, this is a story, and it's been circulating on the web recently, because the Science Channel, you know, it's a series on television, and they have NASA's Unexplained Files, and they just recently aired an episode about the mysterious incident from 1969 in the Apollo 10 mission. Now, declassified in 2008, NASA tapes revealed that three men of the crew heard weird outer space type music while orbiting the dark side of the moon. And for an entire hour, the astronauts discussed and described the music, even debating whether to inform NASA or not. It's a genuine mystery that remains unsolved, for one thing. Apollo 10 was out of radio contact while orbiting the far side of the moon, so the music couldn't have been a transmission from Earth. Also, the moon has no magnetic field or atmosphere that could interfere with their radio. Unfortunately, the actual recording of the strange music isn't publicly available. Now, Apollo 15 astronaut Al Worden keeps an open mind on the mystery, and he even claims the Apollo 10 crew was very used to the kind of noise that they should be hearing. Logic tells me that if there was something recorded on there, then there was something there. NASA would withhold information from the public if they thought it was in the public's best interest. Now, there's one explanation, although it could be some people think it's highly unlikely. The theory is, could the Apollo 10 crew actually have heard the sounds of Jupiter? Now, all planets emit radio waves that can be reproduced as sound, and NASA's Voyager and Cassini spacecraft have recorded musics of coming from these planets. NASA's Voyager and Cassini spacecraft have recorded the sounds from these planets. It sounds like an eerie hum or even a whistle, and actually have a recording of what Jupiter sounds like. So check this out. Pretty interesting.
Mm-hmm.
This sound is audible to human hearing. I mean, and apparently all the planets make their own sound. So you always think of space as being dead quiet. You know, they even talk in the movies, nobody can hear you scream in space because it's a vacuum. Mm-hmm. It's not true. There is sound in the, I mean, you can hear sounds up there. I guess you might have to have a a special machine to pick it up and amplify it. But they say it's within the human hearing range, within between 20 and 20,000 cycles or something.
Huh.
So could they have heard that? And it sounded like music. You ever lay in bed and sometimes your ceiling fan will sound almost like the TV's on in the other room or something?
Yeah, you hear a little something. Yeah, your mind's trying to pick it up.
Yeah, what is it? And then you lay back and you go look and there's no, the TV's not on. You lay back down. You're like, man, I swear the TV's on.
Yeah.
You go look. I think it could be something like that. Of course, there's also people that say, no, you know, the Nazis have a secret base on the backside of the moon, and that's what you were hearing was the music from them.
It's all a cover-up. It's all disinformation. I even read, whenever you're talking about this, that they said that it could have been radio signals mixed. Like, it could have been, as far as, like, bouncing around, I guess, or whatnot, but just something coming from two different, like, module of radio, I guess, maybe frequencies or whatnot, kind of a mixing of the sound. It's one of those things that I don't know that anybody will ever really know what it was.
Well, that's what the conspiracy theorists are saying. Well, if there's nothing there, then how come they won't release the tapes showing what it sounded like? You know, no one's able to hear it. And then other people, of course, are claiming that that's why that they're keeping it hidden is because, yeah, no, it's music playing on the backside of the moon. NASA won't release it because they don't want nobody to hear it.
Now, maybe that is what it is. Who knows?
Yeah. Pretty cool.
Who the heck knows? You remember when I reported on, not long ago, I say I reported. What am I? That's a joke. Sorry, folks. Let me rephrase that. Whenever I discussed, like I'm a reporter, whenever I discussed that little piece that they were going to put into to help like repair spinal columns where they could grow and it had like little I guess like nerve endings, we talked about it, where it would help that. Well, there's some more stuff that's kind of come out like that. This is from discovery.com. Glenn McDonald actually reports on this. Now, this is really interesting. The title is 3D printed hand could serve as scaffold for living tissue. And I never thought about the fact of building something like this to actually have your skin regrow on top of something like that. The first sentence in this article is the greatest sentence ever. It says, thanks to several million years of evolutionary R&D, the human hand is one of the most incredibly complex and sensitive tools ever engineered. And I believe that.
Yeah.
Just look at your hand at what all it can do. It's unbelievable. So they were talking about basically robotic hand design. And that's what this gets into. Well, they're starting to do. There's some researchers at the University of Washington is doing something a little different. They started from scratch, and fundamentally what they started doing was designing the model for artificial hands. Now, there's two fellows from the Department of Computer Science and Engineering, Zaytu and Emanuel Todorov. And they began by laser scanning the hand, it says, of an actual human skeleton, and then using the data to 3D print artificial bones.
That's pretty cool.
It says it allowed the researchers to create a baseline structure, and that way they can account for all these certain peculiarities in the human hand. Now, it says, meanwhile, joint ligaments and tendons on the robotic hand were created from lightweight, high-strength fiber material known as spectra, and then other soft tissues were replicated with laser-cut rubber sheeting. And this is, it results in a layered web-like structure, which is awesome. Now, here's what's funny. Now, it does say this. It says that the third robotic arm drums like a pro. So they've made these robotic hands, and because you've got to see how well it can work. Now, there were some researchers wrote a paper, and it was presented at the International Conference on Robotics and Automation in Stockholm. I think you got that paper. I'm pretty sure it got mailed to you. But anyway, on the paper, it says, our robotic hand design uniquely preserves the important biomechanical information of the human hand on an atomical level.
That's pretty cool.
So what they're going to end up doing is, from what it tells, is they want to take and be able to scan a hand. And what I'm guessing is what if they could do it, like say you lost one in an accident. Well, what if they scanned your, say you lost your right. What if they scanned your left, reversed it, and printed it out? So it's the same exact proportions, let's say, roughly, of the hand that you lost. Or let's say even they had it and it was severed and they couldn't save it, but they could scan the bones in the hand. So they knew that it was going to be acceptable, basically, to your body. Well, they suggest right now that in advances right now with neuroprosthetics and the advances people are making in skin grafting, that they believe that they can end up, not at this very moment do it, but in the very near future, actually regenerate the skin on this hand, much like you would think of Star Wars when Luke lost his hand.
Yeah.
They're going to be able to build something along those lines, and it's already got that same little neuro, like, I guess, some sort of patterns to lead into all of your nerve endings.
Mm-hmm.
And they can weave all that into that that prosthetic hand, lay the skin grafting over it, and your body may never know the difference.
That's crazy.
The nerve endings, the skin, all of it. It will just be a biomechanical hand.
I'm picturing like the Terminator. Remember when he cuts the skin off?
And he peels it off.
I mean, that's basically what it is. It's living tissue over the metal hand or the exoskeleton that he actually is.
Well, that sounds like talking about.
This is what's happening. So I'm picturing the day in the future where before you even have an accident, everybody goes and gets every inch of their body scanned. So in case
once you hit a certain age, when you hit a certain age, they scan you.
Something happens, they'd be like, no, we can rebuild your leg exactly the way it was.
Or what if every time you go in for a checkup or every year you do a checkup, they scan your body just in case. So if something does happen, like you said, you can go back. When was your last checkup? 8 months ago. Well, we got your body scan. We know exactly what sized bones to build and all that, you know, and then we can kind of roughly take measurements of the other scan right now, of the other arm or the other foot,
right,
and build it. It looks like something like this is very possible, like within the next 5 years.
Well, and how many people are these body modification people, the kinds that put horns in their head, or, that screw in.
I got those.
Bumps underneath your skin. You know, how long till these people are voluntarily cutting their limbs off because they want robot limbs?
Well, you're right. I mean,
is there going to be a test like in the Olympics, like when a sprinter sets a new record? Oh, it turns out the guy had robotic legs. We just couldn't tell.
But see, even if it was robotic, it's still the muscles. The muscles still have to work it. You know, that's the whole thing. The bones wouldn't be helping.
I was just reading an article where they were talking about how these bike racers, inside the body frame of the bicycle, they had little motors in there. And they just now figured out that they'd been doing this for a while.
Wow.
Right? So these long distance, like the Tour de France or something. Yeah. Now, it's not a real powerful motor, but it's a little bit. And just that little bit over enough time gives them an advantage.
We'll do anything to win, won't
right?
we? Anything
the
to
amount
win.
Of research and technology that takes them to make these motors that fit inside the frame of the bicycle that are light and make no sound. I mean, you're talking about...
Let's not cure any diseases, people. Let's cheat on bicycle racing.
Right? It's just always amazing how good are the lengths people will go to cheat.
Right.
Pretty interesting. Check this out over here on Open Minds. Our buddy Alejandro Rojas just posted a new article about an alleged retired Navy petty officer who claims to have seen top secret UFO files.
Holla!
Pretty cool. They said this anonymous witness is claiming to have seen thousands of files relating to UFO and ET projects while working at the Naval Telecommunication Center at NAS Moffett Field in the late 1980s. He said he's finally going public because his secrecy agreement has expired, and he would like to see the government disclose what they know about UFOs and aliens. Now, they talk about how shocking these claims are, and a UFO researcher who formerly worked at the UK's Ministry of Defense says that he has no doubts about the witness's background. The witness first made his claims to a report filed with the Mutual UFO Network, or MUFON, on February 13, 2016, and he wrote, "I was a radio man, third-class petty officer at the Naval Telecommunications Center within NAS Moffett Field from February 86 to October 1989, having maintained a TS, SBI, ESI, NATO, SIOP compartmental security clearance. I was required to deliver TS code, world designation, cosmic, and all these other words, it's acronyms for things, and other things to think tanks throughout Silicon Valley. In addition, we had a GS-11 employee who was transferred from a joint US-UK communication station north of London after working at that site for dozens of years. He said that it was on this facility, or at this facility, when he was tasked with tracking UFO data, including Rendlesham Forest incident, as well as many others. I've personally handled, viewed, and delivered thousands of documents involving UFO and ET projects. My secrecy agreement with the U.S. has expired on October of 2014, and at this point in my life, I would just like to share my knowledge in the hope that someone will be able to use it effectively towards full disclosure." Now, a world-famous researcher, Nick Pope, who also worked for the U.K. MOD investigating UFOs and stuff throughout the 90s, he said he looked into this guy's claims, and the guy's all the word, the verbiage that he uses, all the acronyms he uses, these are all things that line up, that make sense. And he thinks that the guy's telling his truth. He said, yes, he's seen documents. This guy's coming out saying that he's seen documents. He doesn't think it's a stretch at all. He thinks that this stuff is legit. And I'm going to ask Nick, because we're going to meet him in about a month when we go up to Arkansas.
We're going to pin him down.
I'm going to ask him about this and see what he thinks. Pretty cool.
We're definitely going to have to do that. We're going to have some, we'll talk about some more of the surprises that we're going to be taking with us when we go to Arkansas up there. But before we jump into the break, we're going to close with this news story because this kind of leads us down the path of what we're going to be talking about on today's show. This comes, of course, from Fox News. says treasure hunters go after gold lost in a wreck off Boston. Now, last summer, the team from the Endurance Exploration Group used an ROV, the remote operated vehicle, and they recovered the fragment from a chamber pot, a glass bottle, and a piece of china that had been sitting on the sea floor about 1,000 feet below the surface of the Atlantic Ocean for more than 150 years.
Wow.
Now, it was confirmation that they had discovered the resting place of the SS Connaught, a 370-foot-long steamer that sank April 21st, 1860, about 100 miles from Boston. Well, now Endurance is formulating a plan to retrieve the Connaught's suspected bounty. Millions of dollars in gold. It says in a lengthy BBC piece, Chris Barnock tells the story of Endurance CEO Micah Eldred's mission to create a profitable shipwreck salvage business and why he chose the Connaught and the challenges Endurance faces as it undertakes what they say a subsea engineering job that they're trying to make respectable. Now, 4 years ago, Endurance began researching shipwrecks that both contained valuables worth salvaging and for which salvage was technically feasible. See, now there's a lot of these shipwrecks that they know is down there and right. that they have stuff on them, but money-wise, you're not going to come out ahead. It's so dangerous and it's not feasibly, you're not capable of basically bringing them up to retrieve anything for them. So there's a balance there. They go so far as they started with 1,500 shipwrecks. They whittled that number down to 20. And out of all of those, the SS Connaught was their best bet. So they started using sonar and they scanned. It says more than 700 square miles of ocean floor until they discovered it in 2013.
Man, that's crazy.
Right? Now, the next year, they go back, they use that ROV, and they confirmed it. Well, in 2015, they recovered these facts. And it says they also became aware of an unanticipated problem. Thick fishing nets snagged on the wreckage, they said, rose hundreds of feet off the Connaught. So they were people who had been dragging those fishing nets. They hung up on it. They had to cut them loose and break them off, you know, over the years.
Yeah.
It's like a spider web hanging up in the water. And they said what they see, that the team figured out a solution. They said perhaps in the form of a giant log-gripping claw, they say it was adapted for maritime use. But they say that the man, Bernick, he's not even motivated by the gold. He said the excitement comes from building a business that's really complicated. And they even call him in the article, Repo Men of the High Seas.
That's pretty crazy.
But it sounds pretty wild, right?
Man, I love the thought of treasure mm-hmm. finding. I think everybody does. And that's what makes today's show so exciting. We're going to take a break, but when we get back from the break, we're going to talk about some of these treasures that are still out there, including the Spider Rock treasure, as well as one that's modern day that still hasn't been found, the Fenn treasure. Stick with us, folks. You're listening to Expanded Perspectives. And we're back with Expanded Perspectives. Ken, before the break, I was talking about, and I really like that treasure story. You know, I feel like Indiana Jones, when we talk about the lost city of Z, or whether mm-hmm. we're talking about whatever these treasures are, I just sit there, my wheels in my head spin. I like to think about dressing with my Penfold hat, or what is it?
And your Penman hat.
Penman hat, and, you know, like a coat. And you always think about these guys, you know, looking, and there's Belloc, you know, these other guys, they're searching for these treasures. I love the stories of these, and especially the ones that are still currently going on. And I was shocked to know that there are all these blogs and forums and things where today there's still like all these massive treasure hunters.
Yes.
You know, you just kind of think of it as something that doesn't exist anymore, but it's totally not true.
Well, we had gotten into looking at some different treasures because Texas is inundated with some really strange treasure stories pretty close to where we're at. So we've been looking at it for several months now. And then we got hit with one of our listeners and friend of the show's, Mr. Robert Smith. And he had sent us a thing and told us about Fenn's treasure. So we're like, that's it. We're going to have to take the next step. We're going to have to do a show and talk about some interesting treasure stuff that's neat. And I found one. The reason I was drawn to this, and I'm going to talk today about the Spider Rock treasure. The reason I was drawn to this is, in a way, I've been there. And when I say I've been there, I'll get to that. But basically, this is how we're going to start out. Now, through the whole past the 1900s, even into this modern time, there's been a ton of people. There's been books written about it. A lot of people have looked into it. We're talking like history professors. I mean, ranchers, of course, have looked into it. Archaeologists, of course, treasure hunters, like Kyle was talking. There's forums that I got on these forums and went to going through and looking at all these where people are constantly. And I don't mean just like metal detector forums. There's some of those. But there are men that are legitimately, this is their hobby.
Where yeah, other I had people no idea like that this was going
yes,
on, right?
That this is what they like to do, that they share some of them. I will tell you this, out of some of the forum stuff that I've read, these people share less of their information than fishermen do. I mean, they will not tell you anything about what they found. But also, too, it's not about going and catching a fish, or you're not talking about the best place to do this or that. This is revolving around money. If you find something, it's going to be a big deal.
And I think that a lot of them are just like I like to imagine. Even finding the treasure isn't fun. It's the fact that you're searching for treasure
yes.
that's fun. And on their weekends, they go up into the mountains. They go down to these valleys with their shovels and
yes.
their detectors and they try to, you know, they find an old map and they're trying to decipher the code. And, you know, I think of what's the show, National Treasure, you know, where
yes.
they're going from place to place to place, deciphering this code. I think that's what people like. It's the treasure hunt itself
yeah.
that's more fun than actually finding the treasure. And then, of course, if you find the treasure, then you can become rich too. So
it's just the whole process. The yeah. process. It's a very romantic thing.
Yeah.
I think we're all drawn to that. We're all drawn to that mystery and that adventure. If you got to hike and you got to walk through and you got to read a treasure map, think of all the stories, not just besides the Goonies, but as we were kids all come up, it was all about treasure maps. How many times as a kid did you draw your own treasure map and be yeah. like, I'm going to bury this jar of whatever I got in the backyard and have this treasure? I'm sure where I grew up, there's probably a couple of things still buried in the backyard there.
I'm sure.
Well, what we're going to talk about is this actually comes, they found a stone, and then they found a second stone, then they found a third stone. It's going to pick up with the second stone finding. They believe it was found somewhere between 1902 and 1905 near a place in Stonewall County, Texas, near a little town called Aspermont. And it was near this town of Aspermont. There is a part of the Brazos River that forks, and it's called the Salt Fork and the Double Mountain Fork. Now, of course, to the people that have been born and raised in mountains, this is nothing more than a hill. But here in Texas, it's considered a mountain, the Double Mountain Fork. What's extremely interesting to me about this is I have been there. I've seen those, you know, like literally stood on the Double Mountains. I've been in this area, had no idea that this was even anything going on. Been on private land. So I may have been in the areas that they had found all this. I have no idea. I'm going to have to go back and do some looking. Then there was a third stone that was discovered near in Fisher County, near a place called Rotan, Texas. Anyhow, they have all these strange symbols, and all three of these rocks have the same symbols on them. But there was an article that was published back in 1963, in October, actually, in Wichita Falls, in their paper there called the Wichita Falls Time. And this fellow writes, it says, a Spanish treasure map found by an Oklahoma hunter in Stonewall County, Texas, a number of years ago, has been problematic for some of the best treasure researchers in the North Texas area. It goes on to say that out of all the Spanish treasure tales in the North Texas area, the Spider Rock story is probably the most authentic because of the finding of the buried map, the number of relics, and ancient smelting sites, and many of the clues the map laid out have been discovered, and some have even reported that treasure was found at some of these spots. Now, of course, there's always a little conjecture. You know, you're always like, well, you found this map, but then you come across this one, and there's stuff. But here's what's really wild is some of these stones were very similar. There's a lot of it's just a really strange story. But there's always like, you know, you find one, you find another one, you find this. It's really, really weird. So we're going to start talking about how they kind of tie together this whole thing. Now, the Spider Rock map You got a picture. It's like black stone that's been carved. You got all these little carvings of these designs on them and letters on them and all this. It was even said that the etchings on that stone were filled with copper. Now, this is what was carved on them. Numerous letters F was carved on them. There was an arrow. There was a diamond. There was a cross. Numerous squares with circles inside of them. Now, they compared them to the second, what they said was a Spanish map, that they say has no name, no kind of background that they can find, and that this has the same, has circles within circles, has snakes, also has squares linked together, has crosses, have the letter F. So if somebody was going to go through the trouble to make this into a hoax, or they had to do a little research and they had to plant basically both stones. And we're not saying that couldn't happen, because it is a little funny the way this all kind of starts rolling together. Now, people have always asked, are these maps like the missing link to this Spider Rock treasure? People, some have said yes, some have said no. There's no real way of knowing, because there's, like I said,
these maps are carved into the rock.
Into the rock.
Now, how big are these rocks?
From what I can tell, the way they don't look huge. I would say they look maybe hubcap sized or something. They don't look ginormous. And we're not talking like a rune stone.
And there's more than one.
There's two.
Okay.
There's two.
And they found them on some guy's ranch or something?
Well, spread across Texas, they found them.
Hmm.
They found one up there, like I said, in Aspermont. Then they found another one near Rotan. They're about 60 miles apart. That's another thing that gets really strange. Okay, I'll tell you this. There was a man named Stewart. And at the time, he was, of course, you know, working and looking into all this stuff, trying to find all this. This is the man from coming down, I guess you could say, out of Oklahoma. But anyhow, he was near that Salt Fork in the Double Mountain. And this dude was working with a group of treasure hunters. And the story goes that they had found the original map. I believe, I forgot when the original map was, let's say the early 1900s, 1902, something like that, was when the original map was found. And it was Stewart and this, and like his group of buddies, you know what I mean? So you have no idea exactly, I guess maybe he's the guy that uncovered this original map. You don't really get a nailed down name of who all was with him to know if it was just a group of like what we have forums now.
Right.
But maybe all of his buddies. So, well, like you do, well, there's a fellow named Dave Arnold, and he shows up in 1902 at the same time that all this is going on, and he has a very unusual sheepskin map with him. So, you know, this is where it gets weird. So they found the one map. So right. Dave looks at this map Stewart had found.
On the stone.
On the stone. So he's like, okay. So he checks it all out. Well, after several months of searching and exploring, and of course, this area is rough that we're talking about.
Yeah, very.
So Dave finds another map on the stone that's now what they call the Spider Rock map. He's the man that found this first one because of, like I said, it's got, they know for a fact that there's Arabic numbers on it. There's Roman carvings on this stone too, which that starts making me start being like, wait, why is there so many other things? It's almost like, you know, you start looking at these rune stones.
So they know that it was the Native Americans that made this.
They don't believe so. They believe that. But there's also some unknown symbols, like cryptic symbols that they think are on there. And then there's a spider web-like design. If you pull up the pictures of the spider rock, you know, stones, it looks funny the way it's laid out. It's almost laid out like, the minute I saw it, I was kind of reminded me of like the Mayan calendar, the way it's got all the angles it shoots off, you know, or something kind of crazy. The story even goes that tells that in the area that he found this, it says that he found some silver impalettes, which an impalette, I was trying to think what it is. Basically, it's an ornamental shoulder piece that goes like on the top of a jacket, you know, a military jacket. He found a silver crucifix, some copper plates, and even found a Spanish sword. Now, that's what the story goes when he found that very first stone, when Dave found his first stone, which is the second stone in the stories of the spider rock.
Okay.
But this first, the stone that Davis found is the one that where they gave the name Spider Rock. So the first one had nothing to do with it. And what I'm guessing is this, it doesn't sound like they were even connected, really. It sounds to me like what I've read, that the very first map that was found by the Stewart guy and his treasure hunting friends had nothing to do with this Spider Rock stone.
It's just two independent maps.
Yeah.
I got you.
It's what it seems like. It seems like it's independent maps. Well, in 1905, Dave moves his search grid. and he goes to a rough plot of Texas land, basically, that's dotted. You got to imagine that's dotted with cedar scrubs, live oaks, just rugged underbrush up there. And the story says that 60 miles southeast, he again unearthed a carved stone map, but this time it was entwined in the roots of a big oak tree. Now, this is the stone, like I said, that was between 1902 and 1905 there near Aspermont in the area that I've been to. That's where he found this one. All right. Now, so that's the stone. That's when I say the second stone, I don't mean like the third stone. This is, if I'm got y'all confused, it's hard to, this is, that's where he found his first stone. Dave found his first stone, the original spider rock stone in Aspermont, Texas, in the roots of an oak tree.
Right.
All right. That's where it was. And that's where he allegedly found the sword, the crucifix, the whole thing. Now it gets wild because like I said, he shows up to this with this treasure hunting friends whenever Stewart had found that first map. And it says that Dave had this sheepskin map, right?
Right.
You jump forward again. Here's where things get really wild because it says again that he moves west-northwest another 60 miles and he uncovers another stone map that's said to have the exact same circles and symbols that appear on his first stone map.
How does this guy keep finding these stones with maps? I mean, like, what would make him go directly to that spot? Like, how does he know that it would
be? Reading the other map is the only thing that I can think of.
You know what I'm saying?
That's why I said 60 miles is funny. How did they keep saying 60 miles? Like, and that was one I told you that was discovered in Rotan, there near Fisher County. Now, the first map that was found by Stewart was on a stone. It wasn't a paper. It's a stone map. All three of the rocks have some of the same symbols.
Hmm. They're but clues. These are like little breadcrumbs.
Dare stones. You know, that's what I kept thinking of, little breadcrumbs. So the very first rocks map that was found by the treasure hunters and all that by Stewart, his matches the last two that are found by Dave.
Right.
All right. Well, Dave Arnold continues to search this whole area for like over the next 10 years looking for all this stuff until 1914. Dave disappears without a trace. Nobody knows what happened to Dave. Gone.
He found the treasure.
That or somebody killed him if he got too close to it. Who the heck knows? You know, maybe the rock fell on him, or you know, they were trying Chester Copperpot. You know, he got killed by the booby traps in the Goonies. Maybe that's what happened to him. I don't know. They say about a decade after he passed away. So I'm thinking 1924 or so, that one of the original seekers that found with Stewart found the original thing. He picks it back up and he's like, I'm going to find some stuff. So now we're in up until the 1930s. They were finding more clues. Like I said, they were finding these real crude smelting pits. Like they were harvesting raw ore and melting it down. And in some areas, they found nuggets of gold and small silver crosses. So people were like, man, we are on the right track. Well, you start getting into the whole idea, at least in my, when I'm reading this, when you get into the whole idea of the Christian based faith of this, is you start thinking of the Spanish, the Spaniards. Yeah. So you're like, okay. So it says, well, the first two stone maps and a lot of the artifacts were being housed at the Terrell Drugstore in Haskell, Texas. Well, Haskell's not very big. We drive to it all the time. We go out in the country out here. Nice little town. But anyway, it used to be there. Well, in 1909, there was a fire in that drugstore, and they believed it destroyed everything. So everything that they had was lost.
Aww.
The stones, the whole deal. But the Terrell family, and we're assuming we're understanding the importance of an unsolved history, or maybe possibly hoping to one day find the treasure themselves, kept a little family secret for almost 70 years. Many of those ancient items that they had survived. They had them. And with them, they had map tracings, letters, documents describing the search. They took it all with them. They kept it there, but they had it all, I guess, copies of it. And I know that I had read that they had rubbings of the stones, a whole bunch of stuff. Now, here's a weird thing I found. The last stone that was found had vanished. Well, it turns up again in Waco. And it had been used as a doorstep. There, right there is a doorstep stone as you're walking into somebody's house for almost 50 years. It had been at somebody's house just in the yard there where they just walked across it. Now, how crazy is that? Right. Like I said, the reason it's pretty wild is it's speculated that the Spaniards had buried some all kinds of gold. Of course, anytime the Spaniards' name come up, you always think of the treasure, vast treasure. They believe that out in West Texas, because that's where they were said to have been mining silver and gold and stuff, that they were burying things and that they marked the sites where they were doing all this with like carved symbols And like we'd always talk about with these certain stones, and that these symbols told, like the stone was almost like a decoder ring, and that would read what these symbols would, you'd have to, you know, line this up to this. This means it's 60 miles away. So you would be able to decipher that by something else that was left there on these sites. That's kind of what they kind of speculated. Now, to this day, the stones still remain undeciphered. People don't know what's really on them.
But they have them.
Are they on display somewhere? I don't know. I've not been able to find a narrow down an exact spot of where they were at. This is just a bunch of stuff that what people say that they know. I'm assuming that they are somewhere. Now, there's when we talked about the spider web design on these stones and stuff, there's actually some numerical numbers on them. The Rotan spider rock stone has a number, the numeral 94 on it. The one in Aspermont has the number 71 on it, and it said it's written as an Arabic number. And then the Clyde spider rock has a Roman numeral on the Aspermont side. So it's all the same. The numerals are the same. Fronts and backs are different, but they're the same numbers on different faces of these stones. So that it's almost like you know they go together, yeah, even though they were that far apart. There's, like I said, on all three stones, capital letter Fs are on all three stones. So that's pretty strange too. Also, it says the numeral 29 appear on the Rotan stone. And when I keep saying Clyde, the original one was found in Clyde, Texas. Clyde, folks, is out near Abilene, about 2 hours west of where Kyle and I am at. Actually, it's right before you get into Abilene off I-20. Clyde's a small town out there in West Texas. That's where the first one was found. So the numeral 29 appears on the last stone found and the first stone found, but not in the second stone.
That's bizarre.
Exactly. It's almost like it's making a circle.
I wonder how many of these stones exist that just haven't been found. Just haven't, you know?
Exactly. Also, that they do say that on those two stones, the letters P-O are on there and the letters C-X-F. And the C-X-F, though, are only on the Aspermont and Clyde stones. So you get that some of the stones, the Rotan and Clyde stone, have one thing in common, and the Aspermont and the Clyde stones have one thing in common. Each one of them is connected to one another. So they do know that. So I got to looking on one of these forums, and this is what I found a guy had actually written, and I should have saved this forum name. This was posted back in like 2006, 2007 off this forum, and it says, "Sorry to disappoint you." A man had asked about the spider rock. He said, "But the spider rock treasure was recovered many years ago." And it says there's a good book about the clues, and this is a good book. I'm going to have to read this. It's written by a man named Steve Wilson. And you can get it on Amazon. And the name of the book is The Spider Rock Treasure. And this fella says that in his usual style, he doesn't give you all the information. And he doesn't tell you that it was recovered. But it's still a very interesting read. It could be that Wilson is not aware that the treasure was recovered. Most people aren't. And that is why he didn't put it in the book. But he says that it's, he said that he believes that it's part of the Spanish origin, this guy does. But he goes on to, this guy asks about it. And the dude that he's responding to, and this guy comes back and said, "I would love to tell you more, however, because of confidence I cannot give out much info, but I can say it was recovered in the late 1950s. It was fairly deep in the ground, somewhere between 20 and 30 feet if I remember correctly. It was Spanish, and it was well worth the trouble of recovery. I will say that Wilson talked about the main location in his book, although I don't know if he realized it or not. There were a couple of smaller caches associated with the main cache that were found, and I believe that there were a couple of smaller caches left behind because they could not be located." So if this guy just on this random forum that's and this guy's from Texas that was talking about this, apparently he knows some people back in the 50s that allegedly actually uncovered all this. So it goes back into you and I talking about things being in private collections. How much of this stuff? Okay. Let's just say that, because I will say this. There's a town just west of Kyle and I, 20 minutes west of us, called Mineral Wells. Several little towns around here. I got to doing some more research in this. I didn't put this in the story, but I will tell you all this. There are two or three guys in Mineral Wells that are big into this story, that did all the research. We're talking back in the 40s and 50s, did all this stuff, looking into it, all the way up to the 60s. These guys have been big into it. So we are surrounded by the men that were involved in this story. So one of these fellas knows what happened to it. There's nowhere that it talks about it being recovered. You start getting on anything to find any recovery, you can't find it other than a few little forum things like this. So either it's all BS, it's never been recovered, and these guys are putting it out there so trying to deter people from looking for it while they still look for it.
Right.
Or it has been recovered and nobody's saying anything about it. It's been tucked away into a very private personal collection and that's it. I can't imagine you just sticking a big cache of some sort of gold and whatever that they left behind, unless, you know, you're selling it overseas on the black market. You're doing something with it, you know, that you shouldn't be doing with it. So I can't really imagine that. But anyway, I thought that was interesting because I've been right there where that's they're talking cool, about.
Man.
I would say within 200 yards of where they found that. I've been to that mountain. If they found it in there, I've been all through Aspermont, up and down the river, the whole thing through there. Yeah, pig hunting.
I'm going to pretend that it hasn't been found and that it's still there because I like the idea of that.
Yes.
And apparently I'm not alone with this love of treasure hunting. There's a man, a millionaire, and his name is Forrest Fenn. Now, this is a very interesting story, like you said, that was sent to us from a listener. I wasn't aware of this. I guess it's a big deal in New Mexico, but not here in Texas.
Never heard of it.
Travel doesn't, you know, doesn't get down. But in a nutshell, Forrest Fenn, he lives in Santa Fe, New Mexico, where he started an art gallery. He raised a family. He collects artifacts. He writes books. And he's made a fortune. Now, I love this guy because what he's done is he's claiming that, the modern day treasure hunting, it's all over. There is no more treasure. Everything that could be found has already been found. Everything's discovered. So he's going to create his own. So basically what this guy did is he purchased an old world bronze chest that he paid $25,000 just for this chest. And inside of it, he filled it with gold, jewels, all kinds of things. This thing weighs about 42 pounds. And he says that the gold isn't just worth the price of gold, but they have historical importance. So it makes the value even more than the gold alone. You know what I'm saying?
Yes.
Now, they say that the treasure is reportedly worth between $1 to $3 million. And it was intentionally hid by this Forrest Fenn guy, who's the art dealer.
Fenn grew up in Texas and as a youth explored the American West. He learned a lot about life's value as a fighter pilot in Vietnam, where he was shot down twice. He eventually moved to Santa Fe and made his millions as a successful art and antique dealer. The idea of a treasure hunt started after he survived a bout with cancer.
I said, I've had so much fun collecting all of these things. Why not let somebody else have the same opportunity that I've had?
He drove out across the Rockies and left the chest.
And when I walked back to my car, I talked to myself out loud. There was nobody around any place. And I said, Forrest Fenn, did you really do that? And I started laughing.
Somewhere in the Rocky Mountains. Now, according to Fenn, many people, they have claimed that they have found this treasure. But he's alive today, and he's saying no. No one has found it. There's a lot of claims. Those were erroneous. They have never been. It's never been found. I know that. Now, what's crazy is he's created this whole poem, which has clues in it, 9 clues. And by reading this poem and buying his books, now look, this could be a very clever way to sell books. He's got these 2 books. And if you buy his books, it's got clues in the books as well as the poem, even maps. Now, it's not a detailed map like you were talking about. It's like, an area.
Yes.
But he's saying if you buy all those books, there's 2, and decipher this poem, that you yourself can find this treasure. And he hopes that he gets to live to see somebody find it. Because it's like, you'll be a millionaire. You'll get to keep it. It's really a pretty interesting story. Now, this first book, which is his memoirs, he calls it, is called The Thrill of the Chase. And it was published in 2010. And it contains this poem I was talking about that leads you to the possible location of this treasure. Now, let me get into this poem. Check it out. Here's the poem, which has 9 clues to the treasure. So maybe one of you can decipher this thing and you can go find it. As I have gone alone in there and with my treasures bold, I can keep my secret where and hint of riches new and old. Begin it where warm waters halt and take it in the canyon down. Not far, but too far to walk. Put in below the home of brown. From there, it's no place for the meek. The end is ever drawing nigh. There'll be no paddle up your creek, just heavy loads and water high. If you've been wise and found the blaze, look quickly down, your quest to cease. But tarry scant with marvel gaze. Just take the chest and go in peace. So why is it that I must go and leave my trove for all to seek? The answers I already know. I've done it tired, and now I'm weak. So hear me, all, and listen good. Your effort will be worth the cold. If you are brave and in the wood, I'll give you title to the gold. So that's the poem.
I know right where it's at.
You do? Well, don't tell anybody. Let's me and you go up there. Now, it's been revealed, you know, he's over time. Now, this guy's legit. I mean, he's been interviewed on USA, on Good Morning America, Today. I mean, it's been widely publicized. And there's huge groups of people that have been going out since 2010 trying to find this treasure, much like you were talking about. He's released clues. Like, for instance, in March 2013, he revealed that the treasure was hidden in the Rocky Mountains north of Santa Fe. Now, that means it could either be in New Mexico. He says it could either be in Colorado, Wyoming, or Montana, but not in Utah, not in Idaho. He's not tricking you. He's letting you know it's in one of those four states. Also, he says that it's located at more than 5,000 feet above sea level. On March 27th, 2013, he came out with another clue. He said that there's no need to dig up the old outhouses. The treasure is not associated with any structures. So he has not hidden it inside of any kind of structure or building. Again, on May 3rd, 2013, he says the treasure is not in a graveyard. So he tells you that it's not in a graveyard. He keeps coming out with these. And he's got another book. The second book is called Too Far to Walk. And it has a pull-out map of the surrounding area where the treasure could be possibly located. Now, as recently as January 2015, he was still revealing these little clues. It seems like almost once or twice a year, the guy will come out with a clue. And in January 2015, his clue was, I know the treasure chest is wet. And then again in July of 2015, this is his most recent clue. He says the treasure is not hidden in a mine.
What has been the response from people who are trying to find this treasure?
I stopped keeping emails at 65,000.
65,000. Add to that.
And it's called the Fenn Treasure Hunt.
The countless more on YouTube.
Es geht den Schatz von Forrest Fenn, ein amerikanischer.
With their own plan.
So I guess this guy's going to keep releasing these little clues, you know, like twice a year just to keep interest up. It's pretty. Now, he talks about how he got started. He had an urge to collect, he says, even when he was a young man at age 9 when he found his first arrowhead. It was just lying there in a plowed field, he said, on Little Elm Creek in central Texas. That's where this guy's from. He said it was just waiting for me to come along. He still claims it's his most treasured object in his whole collection. He said it was a thrill that started me on a long journey of adventure and discovery.
Every time that I went out there to excavate, I felt like I was part of that. When I turned over a potsherd, I would look at both sides. I'd clean it up. If it shined in the sun, if it has a glazed paint, I knew that that was glina, which was lead ore, and that tells me that that pot was made after 1300 when they discovered glina. So you know, it's like reading a history book, except that my history book, everything in my history book is original source material. What happens today is an archaeologist will read books about archaeology, paraphrase them, and say the same thing again in different words. More so with historians than with archaeologists, because there is a lot of new material in archaeology, and there's not much new material coming out in history unless you have a document that turned up all of a sudden. But
now, in 1972, him and his wife, Peggy, built a gallery in Santa Fe, where their primary product was paintings by the old masters of Western scenes, such as Frederick Remington, Charlie Russell, Thomas Moran, and other great Taos painters. But his love for the history of the old, especially the Old West, is what really piqued him, and he began to collect objects of all types of things. So, I mean, this guy's got a vast treasure trove, and this is what's allowed him to become a millionaire. I mean, he even has, like, peace pipes from from Sitting Bull. For instance, he has his peace pipe. All these thousands of artifacts, pot shards, arrowheads,
that's
drum
awesome.
Shields. I mean, he's got a huge collection. And he said he's getting older in age, and he wants to inspire the next generation by keeping this treasure hunting going. And so he's got all this money. He's done well for himself. He's left some for his kids when he goes on. So he took this chest, and he's buried it. And He wants people to find this thing.
That's cool.
So is any of this real? Or is it a massive troll, like I suggested, that's just to sell books and to keep himself in the limelight? I don't know. But I think it's fascinating. And like I said, there's tons of forums. I'll put links to a lot of that in the show notes, where these people are still, I mean, they're insistent. You know, that shows families once a year. They always drive out somewhere and they look for the treasure. And then the next year, they plan their whole year around it. Okay, we didn't find it.
That's
cool. They start
going
through the clues. So next summer, we're going to go to Wyoming. And it takes his whole family and the kids and everything. And they look and they camp out for a week. And they just keep doing this. Eventually, they hope that they find it. But the guy was even saying that, look, even if we don't find it, I'm still having a lot of fun with my friends and my family and my kids. We're going out treasure hunting.
That's cool.
And then you got these guys that are like diehards. These guys are super serious. And they have blogs and things, but much like you were talking about, they don't really give too many clues
because
they don't want to, you know, hurt their competition. And also, like I said, there have been a few claims that people said that they have found it, but there's nothing to substantiate these claims. No one's taken any selfies with it. Nobody's taken any pictures of it. Only Forrest Fenn actually knows what the chest looks like. So he's like, if you found it, show me and, you know, we'll declare you the winner. And he said, no one's ever come through. So much, you know, a lot of people say, oh, yeah, I found it, but not true.
Does it ever make you wonder if it's even there?
That's what I'm saying. Is this just a massive troll?
Well, it wouldn't be that. Because, I mean, I could, just the sense of adventure, just the sense of putting it out there. Maybe the poem makes no sense. And he made sure it made no sense because nobody would ever find it, no matter what you did. And he would never have to say where it was at because it's really not there.
Exactly.
And so people are going to spend the whole time. It's one of those things, it builds more adventure in life.
Well, and
he's talking about
it.
The guy goes with his family.
Yeah, that's what he talks about. Forrest himself says the reason he did this whole thing is he's trying to inspire young people and the younger generation to just keep alive that idea that there's treasure hidden, and you have to put together these puzzles and search, and he wants people to make this quest. So you're right. Even if the treasure doesn't exist, he's still achieving his goal because there are people that are constantly in search of it. So look into it, folks. You perhaps could be the person that finds it. It's called Fenn's Treasure, F-E-N-N. Of course, I'll put links to it in the show notes, but very interesting.
But is it really out there? Assure me somehow that this treasure is real. How do I know that?
The only way that I could prove to you that the treasure is hidden is to take you there.
And what are my chances that you are going to do that?
There's an old saying, two people can keep a secret if one of them is dead.
Okay.
So if I take you out there, I wouldn't want to be your insurance agent.
Hey, this is Aaron T. I found your guys' show about 6 months ago, maybe longer. And after getting into it for a while, I was just amazed that you guys actually take a fair approach to anything paranormal. You don't just be like, oh man, this must be true and listen to this conspiracy, but you actually look at things objectively, even though you're passionate about it. And yes, we all want to discover that one thing, but you don't overhype it. You look at things logically, and I love and respect that, and I really wish more shows would do that. And honestly, you guys are one of a kind. It is very hard to find any other programming like you have. I mean, there's tons of ghost shows and paranormal shows out there, but not the way you guys do it. You guys do a bang-up job. Let me tell you that right now. A real bang-up job.
And we're back with Expanded Perspectives. Thanks for that shout-out, Aaron T. We really appreciate it. If you would like to hear your own voice played during one of our breaks, you have to call the show. That number is 817-945-3828. You can call us, or you can forward us a story, much like Robert did with this story of Fenn's treasure. You can forward that to expandedperspectives@yahoo.com. Or you can go to the website, expandedperspectives.com, look for the contact tab, and you can forward your story over to us, Cam.
Yes.
Pretty interesting stuff, right? These treasures.
Well, it
treasure
is. Seeking. I want to make sure everybody is careful, because when Robert sent us this, this is the main thing that got us going about this, because instantly, when you start thinking about being in the mountains and running around, your mind, if you're a fan of this show, your mind starts leading more towards missing 411.
Right.
You know, you start running around there. Well, when Robert sent this, this is something that came to mind. It happened. It was actually posted January 22nd of this year, folks, of 2016, from KDVR. It says, treasure hunter from Colorado vanishes while looking for gold in New Mexico. Now, it's from Broomfield, Colorado. It says, a treasure hunter is now the one being hunted. In early January, Randy Ballou set out on his search for a hidden treasure he believes is buried near Santa Fe, New Mexico. His raft, dog, and his car have all been found, but there's still no sign of Randy. Now, it says, 2 years ago, Carissa Nevis said her dad, Randy, discovered a new love. She says here that he read Forrest Fenn's book, and he read the poem and got really into it, just trying to find the treasure. Now, it says he's been hunting for treasure of the gold. They say there's somewhere buried in the Rocky Mountains, is what Kyle discussed. Now, she says it feels like a roller coaster. She said that's because that during Randy's latest search for the treasure, he just simply vanished. And it seems, she says, that there's been no clues. And after 3 weeks, which was after the last time he made contact, there's still no sign of him whatsoever. Now, there's a fellow treasure hunter that lives there in New Mexico. Sasha Johnson says a lot of us in the treasure hunting community understood that meant that maybe he would take steps that weren't so obvious to anyone else. So they're wanting to kind of keep it like you were talking about. You know
hush,
what I'm saying?
Hush, yeah.
And it says that Sasha, of course, joined the team of more than 24 others on the trail. Now, she goes on to say that it's not a place that you would want to send people out alone. You have to go out there with a group because it's a very rugged area. Says that Randy's car has been located and his raft was found at the edge of the Rio Grande. This is, and Johnston goes on to say it looked like everything was placed there on purpose. So why would the car, the raft, all of that stuff be there? Boom. Says the dog was found, was very hungry and underweight. So I don't know if it was with them. They don't know what's going on. Doesn't sound like they've got many leads at all for the whole deal, but it does still strike me instantly as the missing 411 thing closed in is something bad happened to this treasure hunter.
Yeah, and you got to be careful, like you're talking about. It doesn't matter where it is. You should never go out alone like that.
Treasure hunt with a buddy in the woods. Don't ever go out into the woods or out anything like that, for alone, folks. We've all done it. We've all done dumb things. We've all just run around to the store without your seatbelt on, or we all grew up wearing no helmet at all, riding your bicycle. Bad things can happen. Little things can mean big things. Just be really careful, and especially if you're going out into the wilds of the outdoors like that, because it's an unforgiving thing.
Yeah, well, you know, I'm not really familiar with the story until recently, but I have been thinking about it since I started looking into it. The man, Forrest Fenn, he's like 86 years old, okay, and he just hid this thing within the last 6 years. An old man probably couldn't get too remote or too far out in terrible terrain by himself, carrying this heavy chest filled with gold and then able to hide it. Do you think that he could do that?
I don't know when he hid it. Because if he did all this, I could easily go hide something right now and wait 20 or 30 years and then start telling everybody to go do it.
That's true. Yeah.
You know, I don't know what his plans were. That's what, like I said, knowing his age, looking into this when you and I was talking about it, knowing his age, it makes me lend to the fact that maybe he's a little eccentric and it's not real. None of this is real. It's only out there. I would like to think there's at least something out there because it looks like a man lost his life looking for this treasure.
He's not the first one. Several people have died.
Exactly. So I don't know. But then again, too, could he have paid somebody? Could he have paid somebody to go put it out there? I mean, who knows? There's so much.
It's a really neat idea, though, right? Because think about it. If you want to leave a lasting legacy, what better way than to create this? He knows that for the next 100 or so years, people are still going to be looking into this thing long after he's gone. And it's just a way to keep his memory going, right?
Isn't there something like that that's called like geocache or geocaching or something where kids and people go do all that where they're getting a group and somebody hides something and they all go look for it. And then if they find it, they got to write their name on it and they put it back for other people later to find or something.
Maybe.
It's something. I think there's a. That's an actual thing I've seen. I don't know. I don't know anything about it because I'm not a young person. But maybe I need to look into it. But I do have something. I'm going to leave everybody here with a little more of an upbeat note. I want to leave this with. We always talked about trying to do feel good stories. We forget about doing them sometime. This was an awesome story when I saw this, and it's just a whole story of love. It's just neat. It says that there's a small town there, Shitomi Town, because it's a beautiful tourist spot. Okay, and it blooms a lot of flowers, and up to 7,000 people can visit this on any day, especially late March or April, because of these giant pastures of beautiful flowers. Now, the land was actually a dairy farm to a couple, Mr. and Mrs. Karaki, and they were married in 1956. Now, every morning they would get up and they would tend their herd of 60 cows while they raised two children in the process. And it says it was a tough yet rewarding life on the farm. And that one day they hoped to retire and stay there, and that he'd be able to take a well-earned trip around Japan. Now, this is a Japanese couple, and they wanted to travel the whole country there. They were married 30 years, and Miss Karaki encountered a problem with her eyes, and it was a complication due to diabetes. The problem was that within just a week, she lost all of her eyesight. They couldn't do anything about it. Gone.
Well, this was a feel-good story.
Well, we're getting there, and it says that she was devastated. Because she knew that she couldn't go on the trip with her husband. And if she did, she wasn't going to enjoy it. She couldn't see anything. And that she knew her husband had always dreamed about this trip, and they had worked, and that was their whole goal, is to be able to retire and tour this whole thing. So she just felt like she was, her life was going to be just consumed with immobility. The husband said that as a result, she shut herself away from the world totally, just living a life of seclusion in their house. Well, it just crushed him. He didn't know what to do with it, just overcome with sadness. And he said that if they could at least have a visitor or two each day, that maybe it would make his wife come out of the shell. So one day, it says that he glanced upon a type of flower, Shizbakazura flower, and it was in their garden, and it occurred to him that the beauty of flowers can be experienced, it says, not only through sight, but through the sense of smell as well. And if he were to create a garden filled with flowers, he thought that his wife could still enjoy their beauty. And that some people may come and visit, he could see her smile again. So it took him 2 years, and he implanted the entire place with the bright pink flowers. It's been more than a decade after the seeds were first planted. It says the garden draws visitors from surrounding towns and people hoping to get a chance encounter with Mr. and Mrs. Karaki, who can often be seen walking on the area. That says if you meet her today, you'll see that her husband has brought a huge smile back to her face because of all the visitors and all the flowers. And it shows her sitting here smiling and walking around with everybody.
Man, yeah. What an awesome dude, right?
That's a good guy right there, isn't it?
Yeah, sure. Yeah. Is.
So, that's just one of those. It made me feel good to look, he couldn't stand seeing her unhappy. I'm going to do something to fix it. So, folks, if you know somebody that's unhappy, go out of your way a little bit, always check on them. The biggest deal is a lot of people that suffer from depression, it is a problem, and that they suffer in private, that they don't really announce that they're going through it. And it's hard for people. So if you know somebody that even remotely you think might have a problem, just pat them on the back, give them a hug, take them out for a drink, go take them out for a walk, just a little thing. Because sometimes the smallest things help many, many people, because since so many people are quiet, and we're all kind of quiet, we all have our inside battles, you never know what that one little thing could do. You could either push them the wrong way or push them the right way. And it doesn't cost any extra to be nice.
That's right.
Doesn't cost any extra.
That's right,
man. Just a good person.
I hope everybody has a good week. For you elite members, we'll be speaking to you on Thursday. For everybody else, thanks for tuning in. This is the only podcast which can lead you to a treasure and make you a millionaire. So we're doing you a real solid, right?
I don't know about that. I think he's rambling. He's mad now. I don't know. He's on a sugar high.
Yeah, right. Well, everybody take care. Thanks to the Black Angels, Pretty Lights, Inner Traditions, New Page Books, Warwick & Associates, Llewellyn Books, Ancient American Magazine, Phantoms and Monsters. Have a great and safe week. I'm Kyle Filson. He's Cam Hale.
Peace.
talk.